I started my career, you know, I grew up in Mumbai, and surprisingly, I started my career in something which is very far from digital. Also, I started 20 years back. So digital was not as big in neither in this country. You know, some of the major e-com companies that we now talk about, Amazon, Google, you know, were just starting about. So I started my career in banking, despite having an engineering degree, but with no MBA. So, you know, I started with a major bank, did about a year, but I quickly grew out of it. And my you know, initial passion growing up was always sales and marketing. So without an MBA, I you know, headlong went into sales and marketing. And I also got into engineering sales. So I thought that was the best combination. You know, somewhere I felt guilty for not doing anything to do with engineering for a year. And so I got into engineering sales. I also moved out of India. I went into a career that eventually transcended retail as well as commercial project sales. I worked for Philips in the first one decade for a brief amount of time. And I spent time everywhere across the globe. So I think very fortunate to spend the first 10 years of my working career outside India, primarily due to the exposure. I traveled 53 countries, ran retail, wholesale, B2B, and private label across Middle East, Eastern Europe, North Africa, and APAC. And somewhere around 2011, the whole bug of, you know, doing more with technology started biting, you know, started biting me. I started to realize that B2B and B2C and everything I was doing would transform in the next decade. And so I had to catch that train, right? So I decided to come back and study after the decade of working. I did my MBA guided by, you know, some of the best professors, and also got a chance to interact with some of the best and brightest minds who were just starting their career. So essentially 8-10 years younger to me. And I then moved on to e-commerce in Amazon. So I was part of, I joined Amazon in 2014, was part of two major teams. Amazon was just starting off in India. Firstly, was part of their founding B2B Amazon business team, and was responsible for the launch of very interesting categories in e-com under Amazon business, you know, medical supplies, sporting goods. And whilst I was doing that, I also got the opportunity to, you know, explore general trade. We were looking at how to build an omni-channel strategy, primarily for mobile devices. And I did that for a brief bit. I then moved on to another role at the B2C side. I moved on to leading a part of their mobile exclusives portfolio. So, you know, lots of experience around wireless handsets, around omni-channel, and around B2B. I joined Adidas last year. So in a sense, my 20 years of journey till 2020 has been a mixture of a lot of things. And it's, you know, it's quite, I find it nostalgic and a little bit of amusing when someone calls me a digital and brand leader. I do believe that, of course, if you were to ask me this question in 2013, the answer would be different. But talking about the market of 2020 or 2021, I think it's actually more homogenized. Having seen multiple countries, there are a couple of things that are pretty similar on the B2C consumer space across every geography. A, consumers are aspirational, right? Everyone's always trying to, you know, trying to see what's the best product for them, for their families, for their kids. And they're always trying to get more and more educated about their products. So, you know, back in the day, 20 years back, across various geographies, probably, you know, it was a lot of what we bought or consumed was, not to say that consumers were less educated, but they're asking more and more questions, and they're asking more and more right questions. And I would say that that trend started overseas in some of the Western countries. But today, if I go to India, I mean, if I talk about India, if I talk about South Korea or any of countries in Asia, we're just literally all the same. Having said that, I think if you talk, and India is a large country again, right? So again, it's very hard to paint all of India in one brush. But if you look at a smaller country with a higher purchasing power, of course, the kind of products that are sold there, the purchasing power parity is higher. So the kind of price on the price spectrum, it might be different, right? So even on the handsets, devices space that I came from, a lot of Western countries are iPhone, Apple countries, whereas you have a spectrum of Android devices and all of them do well in India. So I think from a purchasing power parity, that's there. Also, I would say choice of products, right? Depending on which part of the spectrum from you on which part of the life cycle you are, it varies. So for example, in a country like India, which has a very large young population, there is more demand around products that are aspirational, around homes, around education, and all of that. So in a sense, demographics, purchasing power are the big differentiators, but overall aspirations and knowing more about the product is now, I think, a standard universal metric across all economies. I'll actually, from a brand perspective, so because Amazon is a very large retailer, e-com retailer, and that's e-com marketplace. Sorry, Amazon's a large e-com marketplace. Cloudtail is more of a retailer, and Adidas in India is a brand when we also do our own retail, right? I would say from a consumer, let me talk about, more from a retail and brand perspective, because marketplaces like Amazon, provide a platform for retailers to buy and sell. But I think from a strategy perspective, and more so in the new era, right? When I say new era, I'm talking about the last 2 years, although change has been on for quite some time. I think the whole volatility of the last 18 to 24 months have been tailwinds.
So much more has moved online.
Yes. So I do believe that, firstly, I would say everybody, I think, whether it's a small brand, big brand, large corporate, the increasing use of data, right? I think you have digital-only brands, you have digital-only marketplaces, which are rightfully so. Then you have brands like us who operate in the physical space, in the digital space, and multiple other spaces. I think the use of data, and I think getting data onto one platform is super critical. More so if you're a omni-channel player, right? If you're in retail if you're in retail, physical retail, and e-com. So I believe understanding the consumer and the and why do I say this? Because today the consumer is, I would say, is truly more omni-channel than the India approach, right? Because they can choose what to buy, when to buy, how to buy, why to buy, right? And they will, if you're not there at the time and place of their choosing, then you probably lose an opportunity to interact and even probably sell, to the consumer. So I would believe all players in India, and very, very interesting, right? We are also a country which is very unique. Prior to the whole digital explosion, we would probably be the country with one of the highest general trade, application. When I say general trade application, I'm talking about mom and pop stores, unlike the West, where there's organized retail. And we are the fastest digital, retail growing country. So imagine you have a large population which kind of appreciates both. So I would say any brand truly has to look at how is your consumer, what are you trying to engage or inspire the consumer with? And if you are trying to engage and inspire the consumer with something, what values of yours resonates with the consumer? When would they want to buy that, interact with you? And why would they want to interact with you? And to do that, you need to collect data. Firstly, I think in the broadest sense possible. And I think collecting data is still an easier part, but more importantly, mining it to get the right insights, because data is available plenty, right? So what data do you use? How much do you use? And thirdly, I would say having a true, I would say only a physical retailing mindset or a digital retailing mindset, having an entire organization think omni-channel, because that's so critical, right? Having the right mindset on using data to help physical retail sell better, and using, people who handle digital, kind of getting the tribal knowledge of physical retail into your machine learning and algorithms. So I think that's going to be very critical in the next 3 to 5 years for the brand, if it's not already happening. Lots of brands are doing a great job, right? I mean, brands, marketplaces, almost everyone. Let me take a few examples. If you go to the beauty and cosmetics segment, there's some of the major brands, including marketplaces like Nykaa. You now can also, shop Nykaa in physical retail. It's not only a marketplace. Sugar Cosmetics is one. We ourselves do a lot on omni-channel ourselves, right? You could walk into our stores if the selection is not available on the store, if it's our own retail store, someone's going to help and guide you to buy the selection on our e-com site. there are many more programs that will probably get rolled out, but what I've seen with good brands is that you could walk into a store and buy on e-com. You could buy on e-com and get a hyper-local delivery from a store. So there's a lot happening there, right? I think on multiple places. So what I'm seeing is physical retail, I mean, digital brands, digital first marketplaces, like I explained, Sugar, Nykaa, you know, so many of them have actually now gone into physical spaces. What we're also seeing is physical retailers coming onto the digital world, right? You know, lots of folks are getting, of course, onto the marketplaces, but everyone's always almost running to a D2C brand as well. It's a large spectrum again, right? You have FMCG brands, you know, also getting into the digital D2C space. Even though I think transactions might most likely get completed on the marketplace, but at least giving enough information about their products. And then there are also brands like ourselves, which are, we just launched our own e-com site 3 weeks back. We directly now operate our own e-com site. And so we actually see a lot of transactions happening on that site, because there are, as a brand by itself, you know, we would also succeed very well in our own retail, a single branded outlet, right, that we would run. So if you had to ask us about 4 or 5 years back, we didn't have a major digital presence ourselves. So we've also now evolved strongly into a digital presence. So I think those are some of the brands, you know, who are looking to transcend both spaces. And I think a lot of brands and marketplaces are doing it well, to be honest. Firstly, I think mapping the consumer and the value of your products is very important. Now, I say this, it's more broad, but take a large brand or, you know, someone who probably sells anything from luxury to utility, right? And there are lots of, and take the example of FMCG, right? You have premium teas, you have, you know, there are FMCG brands who have probably a special version of tea for every region in the country, right? The North has a different brand of tea, the South has a different brand of tea. And in that also there's premium and luxury. You actually need to know your consumers. And I think that's not changed. You needed to know your consumers. If you were in physical retail, you need to know your consumers if you're an omni-channel. And more importantly, you need to map and find out what drives the purchase when. Now, just to give you an example, if it's a very low involvement purchase, I know how it looks like, I know how it feels like. Convenience plays a big role, right? I probably would like to sit in my house and not even step out to buy it, right? Again, it depends. And I'd like to add the point and go back to one of your previous questions where you asked me, what's the difference between some of the markets, right? I've seen this even in the Middle East where I worked for a few years. A lot of times, physical retail shopping was also an experience by itself, right? People would shop, even if convenience came, they would still stroll into the malls on Fridays, Saturdays and enjoy doing that, right? But I think in a mass market like India, who buys what, when and why? What's the expectations? Is it a high involvement purchase? Is it a low involvement purchase? Does it require technical selling? Once you do that, I think you are able to identify to a large extent. Of course, there will always be outliers. What products will sell better where? What will sell better in the physical format? What will sell in the digital format? And what kind of skill sets you need in both? When I say skill sets, I'm also talking about skill sets in digital, right? So for example, will high involvement products sell in digital? Yes, they will, but you need so much more to tell the consumer, whether it's content, whether it's videos, whether it is, you know, the ability to connect to a consumer care center executive. So that's the first point. I think know your consumer well, map their value, always stands as the first point. The second point, of course, is data. I would say, again, you know, I'll harp on data again. Data availability, getting them onto the single platform, and you'll find even today, I think data scares a lot of people, right? Because there are so many, earlier, I think data was limited, but the explosion has happened so fast and so quickly that now actually data is scattered with a lot of people, right? So getting it all together and driving insights, strong insights, right? And also insights is, again, can overwhelm brands, retailers very, very quickly. So what insights are needed, what are not, where do you stop and what do you action is, again, super, super important. I would say the third is mindset, right? It's a lot of change for traditional ways of working, both ways, like physical retail has to embrace digital, digital has to embrace physical. So how do you get the best practices of both together? I think these are the top three points, I would say: mindset, data, and consumer. These are the top three points you need to actually, you know, double down on in getting an effective strategy as a brand retailer in the coming years. It really depends on the objective, right? And that's one of my favorite points as well. What are you trying to achieve with the data? That should usually lead to the questions, right? Now, for example, if from an entire e-com journey, let me take the e-com journey and let me take a physical journey. From an entire e-com journey, if your objective is, you know, what's happening, so, and e-com has various metrics, right? It has conversion, it has average order value, it has units per transaction, it has traffic and all of that. Depending on the problem you're trying to, and I won't say problem, but it's also opportunity. Depending on what you're trying to do, you have to go deep into that question. For example, if you have consumers who are probably, they're buying coffee and you want them to try a snack, or they're buying sportswear, they're buying apparel, but they're buying track pants and you want them to try, you realize that probably they are very early stage in their journey. They're buying training track pants, right? And you want them to move to at least trying or getting to more active running. That's basically what you need to look at. You need to look at what is the consumer doing and what are you trying to get them to do. And then look at the relevant data and ask the right question. So asking the right question would then it would evolve into saying that, hang on a second, but a conventional consumer journey, and you always have a prototype journey, right? You always have a prototype journey that if this consumer had to behave ideally, this is the steps he or she would take and this is what he or she would do and go. Now, at which point of this journey is this getting broken? Is it getting broken on the digital side? Is it getting broken on the fact that they just found a utility product and just checked out? And so can I show something else? Can I recommend or can I personalize better? Or is it something else? So I think if you design your ideal consumer journey, which is standard marketing practice, right? You do A/B tests, you do all of that, and then figure out where it's broken. Probably you deep dive into the data there. In the physical retail space also, it's kind of similar, right? I mean, when you say ask the right questions, 5-10 years back, when we used to run retail and wholesale and, you know, consumer selling, we would technically go to our biggest stores and ask our sales people, right? Okay, tell us what's the data. Today, I think it still holds true. I think nobody better than your sales folks to give you the best analysis of the data. But probably with the use of, you know, technology, with the use of heat maps are also making their ways into stores, right? One way or the other, sensor technology and all of that. You are able to give data to back their intuition, because the intuition is always there, or sometimes even challenge the intuition, right? What's leading to what? Is there causality? Is there no causality? So that's, I think, the benefit of technology. But yes, what's your ideal consumer journey and where is it breaking off should be a good starting point to ask the right question. I think almost everyone is at the same starting point. And why do I say that, right? The advantages that probably a large corporate would have earlier was access to technology, which would be a significant moat, access to logistics, which would be a significant moat, access to supply chain, which would be a significant moat, and sometimes access to production also, right? But if you look at the last few years, almost all of it has been democratized, right?
Technology, I was just going to say so much more of that is democratized. Yeah, absolutely. Correct.
So I would say the advantages, I think, to I would, and you know, anybody running digital in a large corporate would almost tell you the same thing, right? Everyone feels like a startup, right? I think lots of good corporates and brands who are doing it right have almost, told their digital teams, or, you know, they understand that digital is probably, you know, evolving or emerging really fast. So I think that's the need of the hour. And so I would say it's almost the same. It's just that I think, I would say there are challenges both sides. From a smaller brand, I think sometimes, or not smaller brand, but even someone just starting up, if it's a, because my wife is a startup founder herself, so I can relate some part of that. Sometimes you need to probably, run really fast and collect the data because you're trying to build the brand at the same time. So for you to even get a lot of data to make sense of it, you need that many consumers, right? I mean, and then it's almost like a flywheel. Whereas when the moment you start getting transactions and scale, the question is what I already said, right? How do we get it all together? How do you ask the right questions? How do you make the right insights? And how do you take it together? So I would say it's an inflection point, because there's a point when you have enough data to make meaningful decisions about it, but it's like almost like a, you know, how much water is enough, right? You open a dam, there is a significant amount of water that's needed, but if the dam breaks, there's too much of water. But if the dam shuts, there is no water. So I think the right optimum mix of data and its usage, and how do you do that if you're a small startup, or how do you do that as if you're a big corporate? And again, that has a lot of other things that go with it. It's mindset, it's systems, it's processes, it's challenges. So I think that's the inflection point I'd like to talk about. I would say, look, and for someone who's seen both sides of, you know, like you said at the start, old economy and new economy, I would say the organizations, companies, and professionals who have succeeded really well are people who have appreciated both sides of the spectrum, right? And that's mindset. I think I usually find that people who have, I mean, not usually, but a lot of times I find people who have been in the physical domain world for a long time, they look at digital as something very hard, or something, not hard is the wrong word, sorry, but something quite overwhelming, right? And now with democratization, and it's, of course, I think in that sense, it's been a huge tailwind because everyone's been forced to adapt. A lot of people are now getting more and more comfortable. So I think that's the other part. Also from the other side, right? I think a lot of, you know, folks have probably, lots of people believe that digital is the only route to success. And I kind of take a different approach to that, because I believe physical retail is also here to stay, right? It's not going in a way. Ours is a large country. Lots of times you want to talk to someone. So I think that's the major mindset, you know, appreciating the other side, especially if you're on one side. If you've transcended both, it's fine. And secondly, I think would also be around problem solving, right? When it comes, because folks would have sat on one side of the divide, they kind of, which is what we just spoke about, right? The consumer aspirations approach, yes, the way they think has changed. The way Gen Z shops is different from what a Gen X shop, what millennials shop is different. And that would have happened anyways, right? Technology has only accelerated it. But the basic fundamentals of how you approach customer segmentation, what a consumer is looking for, how do you look at variables, how do you conduct tests, have not changed. And, you will still see, and you will still probably, if you pick up, if you're someone who loves reading or someone who follows this, is a keen student of it, you will still see that a lot of what is being spoken has changed, but it's not been outdated. So I think that's also a very critical thing to remember. I've always looked at, you know, most historical events as a short-term impact and a long-term impact. And, you know, fantastic book, if anyone's listening and wants to hear or read the book, there's a book called Psychology of Money. Which talks about how someone born during World War II, or the Great Depression, would have a very different view of money and economy compared to someone born in the 90s, right? Because we've been fairly exposed to opportunity. The world hasn't seen a major war in the last few years, right? All of that. And I think this is one of those, you know, world-shaping events. And why is it world-shaping events? Because a couple of things. I think brands, retailers, marketplaces, everyone's starting to wake up, if they hadn't already, to the fact, it's almost a jolt, right, that you need to be ready on all, I mean, you need to be truly omnichannel, right, when it comes to selection, when it comes to your offering, your value, where you are, when you are, it's the consumer's choice. And it could be choice from a consumer, or it could be a forced event like COVID, right? I mean, that's, I think, at least for the next 10 years, no one's going to forget it, right? As long as this workforce continues. The other thing is, I also spoke about us being a strongly differentiated nation, right? I mean, physical retail's always been there. And as a new generation transcends into the workforce, even people who ran physical retail, you know, as their kids start working or start businesses and ventures, I think we're going to see an amalgamation of physical and retail. Same to my first point. But more importantly, I think people are also going to make a lot of smart choices, right? I think it's, and it's not just COVID, but it's also to do with how the world has evolved over the last couple of years. So earlier in the 60s or 70s, people spoke about what, I mean, brands advertised or brands wanted to tell them, right? Then it changed with a lot of search available, a lot of social activism is on the rise. Topics like sustainability are on the rise. So it's not just a one-way communication, but it's a two-way communication, right? And it's in various forms. It's on forums, it's on digital footprints, it's on physical retail, and those questions are only going to get more and more sharp and focused. I think the third most important point, and it's not a change point, which is actually related to the second point, right? It's not only going to be information from one source, it's going to be information from multiple sources. What's available in, you know, traditional marketing, what's available on what other consumers are talking about, your brand, product, article, consumers you have never met, which is ratings and reviews, but also social commerce is making a play, right? Back to the days when probably our parents bought stuff from someone they knew, someone who sold them. So it's all coming together. And I think, businesses and brands that excel will have to excel in every sphere. There's not going to be that I can excel in one sphere and probably slack on the other two. I think it's going to get more and more, I wouldn't use the word demanding, but it's also going to get more and more omni-channel in that sense. And you'll have to almost become an all-rounder rather than become a single-dimensional student. I believe the first point is to get your product, which is what I spoke about on the path to data, right? I think the first point is to get your product out in the hands of as many people as possible. And given that, physical retail generally has its own cost structure, unless you are part of a multi-brand outlet or you can convince someone to, you know, keep your product and get consumers to try, which is generally been hard in India because retailers have their own metrics. They have to optimize for space, optimize for turn, stock inventory turns. So, and in that sense, I think, being online and having the widest, because that's the key thing, right? Having the widest distribution is most important. However, I think that was also true for about 4 or 5 years back when very few people were getting onto online. Everybody, even, smaller brands were trying. And so if you remember, you would see a lot of success stories from brands in the early years, brand on digital, who actually made a big name in digital, right? Without coming physical. And then physical retail would move on to say that, acha, it's selling well on the marketplaces, can we also stock it? I think marketplaces also have now a lot of products, but having said that, what's the differentiator? So using data to differentiate, because think of a consumer, right? If you go onto any of these marketplaces and search for any common product, you will find about hundreds of listings. So having a very sharp strategy around how do you get your first 200, customers, ratings and reviews, and how do you get customers to endorse it? What is their feedback? And sometimes you could start digital, but being connected with your consumer through calls and through constantly getting their feedback is also important. But the second is, how are you using the data that some of these digital mediums give you, right? What are consumers searching for? Basically optimizing your limited budget to make sure that you get a bang for the buck. What's the search terms they're looking for? What are the keywords? Does your product detail page carry those keywords? I think optimizing on that is also critical around that, because that helps differentiate. And I've seen this actually work very well for a lot of B2C brands in the last 3 to 4 years. It really depends on, at which point you decide to do that, right?
Right.
And just taking some typical case studies that have been there, right? I mean, there are brands like Sugar, we just spoke about, which have scaled enough and now have their own niche space in, malls and shop and shop in a sense, right? So, so if you scale to that level and you've been digital for that long, then definitely. But when you have So it's almost, I think the framework I would use is fixed cost versus variable cost, right? When you put your own store, I think the back of envelope working you need to do is that, would you have enough demand or can you create enough demand, right? Let's say within 3-6 months, and you might not have enough demand, but the fact that it's an experience that only you can give might ensure that you have enough demand in the next 6-8 months. And then it might make complete sense to put your own store. But having said that, it's a bit like, you know, folks also, I mean, even from a, why take physical retail, even own retail, I mean, even digital retail, right? Just that the cost of running your own direct to consumer in digital is relatively cheap, right? I mean, you can host a website, you can tap a lot, like we said, democratization of all the process. And if that was there in physical retail, yes, go for it. But the fixed cost part of, you know, having your own capex, having your own store staff, and there's a lot of fixed costs which you need to cover with a certain amount of demand to go there. Whereas if you go to a large retailer, depend again, no right or wrong answer, but you are then you have, so from a digital perspective, what do you have with a large retailer? You have traffic which is assured. You have there is the consumer who's walking into that store, but what you need to do is then differentiate. And so maybe you can differentiate to whatever your product attributes, or you could just have one or two people to help differentiate, to sample and all of that. So depending on the stage at which you decide to do it, and depending on your product, I think that's where you should pick the point. That's the framework I would use. Two things. Firstly, is the marketplace getting crowded? Yes. I mean, what was true for physical retail is now true for digital marketplaces as well, right? Physical retail earlier, I mean, even some of these big, you know, big multi-branded outlets, or for that matter, even a small retailer, right? Everyone talks on stock turns. Now, with e-com and digital retail, I think there are multiple models where you can stock it in your own warehouse. So everyone's happy to show the product. The question is, there are millions and millions of products online, right? So it's even hard for the consumer, you know, to search. And I think a very, a quote I often like is, you know, what they say is that if you want to find a dead body, the best place to hide a dead body is on the second page of Google search results. And this is also true for, you can substitute it with any e-commerce marketplace, right? Having said that, look, I think it's always going to be a journey. The way I would think about it is to do a lot of A/B testing. Firstly, I think it starts from what are you trying to look at, a lot of data, right? I mean, very often what I've seen, common mistakes and fallacies around building brands is that the differentiation is kind of very, very limited. So is it a large problem? Is it a large addressable segment? And if it's a large addressable segment, what is it that they are looking for? And it doesn't have to be something drastically different. Don't get me wrong. It doesn't have to be something drastically different. So one way, what I think from a technique perspective, I'm just going to use the digital lens, because I think in the physical world, there are lots of ways to ask questions. There are surveys, enough is written about marketing literature. But since digital is new, one way that I have always used to a large extent and continue to advocate is to look at how did the consumer arrive at your product detail page itself, right? What are the search words that they looked at? And you have a lot of data available with some of these marketplaces, which they will even share with brands. And D2C brand, right? What are the most commonly searched keywords? People who bought your products, what keywords did they search for? What's the engagement rate? And that's one way of looking at it. The other way of looking at it is also, what are the searches that people made which didn't find any results, right? And there are tons of them, right? I mean, they're also called as no search results. If you go and look at that, that also gives you a deep insight of looking at what could be done. The other way is communication. I would say, don't overclutter your communication. Try one or two. There's incredible power in focus always. Try one or two small experiments. Don't run A/B testing on, like, you know, five variables on each side. That kind of gets messy. But if you can run it on one variable or two variables, whether it's copy, whether it's content, or whether it's product, either ways, I think that's what really helps. So I would say search results, consumer journey, people who were, you know, and not just that, what did they look for? Or even people who didn't buy. I think, I mean, in my time, I know that lots of, you know, e-com players are also willing to search, saying that, hey, why did you not get the order? Like, if people didn't buy your product, did they go and buy a correlated product? Or did they just... So if someone came and looked at your product and went and, let's say you're selling, for example, you're selling a deodorant and someone went and bought books, no problem. I think somebody was just window shopping. But if someone didn't go and buy your deodorant and went and bought something else, there's enough data around looking at that. And that could be a good starting point to see where, is it a product question? Is it a price question? And to dig deep into that.